Good morning, everyone. So for this talk, what I've done is kind of rounded up a bunch of just my favorite stories that sound too wild to be true. There is one piece in here that is not true. And so when we're done, I'm going to cheat, see if anybody figures out which piece is not true. It's not the whole story, but it's a big piece of one of the stories. And I like to think that all of the stories are really good candidates for not being true. They're so ridiculous. And some of the things may be stories that you are familiar with, but I'm going to introduce a side of it that you may not be. All right, let's get going on it. And I'm happy at the end to answer any questions about any of these stories or anything else unbelievable about St. Louis history that you may have burning in your mind. I like questions that, especially ones that stump me, because that gives me something to go in search of afterwards. All right, so our very first one is, I always have to give, whenever I do talks about unbelievable history or wild things, I have to give respect to this photo because it is one of the most unbelievable wild photos in our collection. If you can catch what's going on there, there is a horse being pulled out of a sinkhole while everybody watches and one guy pulls. You notice on the lower right there is one guy doing all the work while his friend is tapping him on the shoulder. He is doing that. All right. So our first story is about a circus train wreck. And we don't have any photos of this train wreck because it happened during a time period when we didn't have photos, but we had drawings in the newspaper, which I'll show you in a moment. But I do have some fun photographs of circus stuff from our collections. And they are mostly from the police circus. Does anyone remember the police circus? Yeah, so this is a big piece of St. Louis popular culture that ran from 1900 into the 1960s. And it's something that I love learning about and digging through because they would bring traveling performers. There were a lot of local performers that would be there every year. It was at the arena. It was at the Coliseum. It moved throughout St. Louis and then ended in the 1960s. And what's interesting about researching this police circus is that you have the last one, but then it's used, police circus is used for several decades later as an inside joke reference whenever something happens crazy with the police. There's like a little inside joke the journalists use that if you've been around in St. Louis, you would get. So it kind of turns into a little side thing. So the story that we're going to do, I'm going to read the news story itself because it's from the New York Times. It's from the day after this particular circus train wreck happened. We do have these drawings from it. John Robinson's circus train was wrecked at the Union Station this evening, and a pair of lions, a tiger, a leopard, and a hyena succeeded in escaping from the cages. The excitement was intense for a few minutes, but the animals, being of the circus kind, were more scared than the people and were easily captured. The train had just arrived from Fort Scott, Kansas, where the last stand had been made, and its destination was Cincinnati. The train consisted of 20 flat cars carrying animal cages and circus paraphernalia, and 3 passenger coaches for actors and employees. Here's where the story gets good. A stop was made in the Missouri Pacific Yards, and when the signal to start was given, the train pulled out rapidly toward the bridge. As one of the front cars was passing over the puzzle switch, it jumped the track, and the cars and cages in the rear dashed over it and collided with a freight train going in the opposite direction. A canvasman named James Squires was killed, and 2 others were dangerously injured. The lion cage was shattered, and the lion and his consort leaped out onto the track and circled the wreck twice. And when the people fled, terror-stricken, the lions did likewise. They crawled under the wreck, leaving nothing to be seen but their tails. The tiger made a beeline for the baggage room and took refuge behind some trunks. The hyena dodged under a freight car and howled. The leopard ran around for a few minutes and knocked a couple of men over and then jumped back in the wrecked cage. The lion tamer was the first man to the rescue. He grabbed the African monarch by the tail and dragged him out from under the wreck and tossed him into another cage. Then he seized the female consort by the tail and neck and led her into the cage. They both seemed grateful to him for the protection thus tendered. They had never seen the jungle and were not bad animals. One fiery gentleman shot twice at the tiger in the baggage room, but the lion tamer took the frightened beast by the neck and led him into a boxcar. The hyena, meanwhile, was being stoned by some bad boys and was howling mournfully when rescued. A big boa constrictor was cut to pieces under the wheels of a car. Two mountain lions were hurt. The tiger was shot in three places, and the hyena lost half his tail. A pair of ibexes were killed, and a half dozen monkeys are still at large. There is no follow-up story that I can find about those monkeys. If they were ever found, they're out there somewhere, living. I like to think there's a subterranean monkey society here in St. Louis. All right, so our next story, that's story number one. This is Pearl. So now we're going to talk about Pearl Curran and Patience Worth. Is anyone familiar with their stories? So it's like the best, one of the best, most prolific ghostwriters, like literally ghostwriters in St. Louis history. So in 1913, Pearl Curran, that is this lady over here. So Pearl Curran is a St. Louis housewife. She has no interest in ghosts or things like that. She's also, she plays with a Ouija board like most people do around that time. It's a fad. She plays the piano. She's not very educated. Lives a good life in the Central West End. She's married. She and her husband don't have any kids. So one day she is playing the Ouija board with her mom, and according to the story, the Ouija board started moving of its own accord. And when it did, the message that it spelled out, the first message, was "Many moons ago I lived. Again I come. Patience Worth is my name." So Patience Worth, according to Patience Worth, had lived in Dorsetshire, England, in 1649 or 1694. She kept giving different dates. And that was hard to get her to even give the dates. Patience spoke in an archaic language. She used thee and thou, which all this could be fake, right? Like this is starting to set up to be like, okay, we're not real here. But then it gets really weird. They start pushing her for more information, and the spirit replies, "About me, you would know much. Yesterday is dead. Let thy mind rest as to the past." Eventually, Patience would say that she did come to America, and she was murdered when she lived on the East Coast. Great. So first, they meet her on the Ouija board, and they think that's how they find Patience. And she doesn't go away; she's always there. But she only talks when Pearl has her hands on there. So Pearl is really fascinated by this. Again, she's not into the occult. This is something that's like, this is fun. We'll go with this. So Pearl, they continue doing it every day. Eventually, the messages start coming so fast, no one could write them down. And Pearl realizes she doesn't need the Ouija board. So the sentences start forming in her mind at the same time they were being spelled out on the board. So then she begins to dictate the messages from Patience to anyone that would write them down. So then they eventually have a secretary. They have people that show up every day to take these messages down. For 25 years, Patience Worth, through Pearl, dictated a total of 400,000 words. They weren't just words and sentences. They were plays, novels. The novels all were published to critical acclaim. 5,000 poems, a play, many short works, and several novels. Again, Pearl Curran is not educated at any level and had no interest in literature and was not, this was all just something that was kind of happening. People came from all over. The Currans would let them in their house. There was no admission. There was no tablecloth on the, nobody's kicking underneath the table or anything like that. It's just coming through, and she can smoke a cigarette while doing it. Like, this is the whole thing. And this is one of the pieces of evidence of that people have been unable to prove what was actually going on, because if you had split personalities or any of these things, you wouldn't be able to toggle back and forth between yourself smoking a cigarette and someone from the 16th century. Like, you wouldn't do that. So Pearl would explain that words would flow into her head, she would feel a pressure, and then scenes and images would appear. And she would describe the scene to someone that was writing it down. If two characters were talking on the road, she could see the roadway. She could see the grass on either side and perhaps a landscape. If they spoke in a foreign language, she could hear them speaking above them, but she would also hear patients translating the language. And so the patients would interpret it and tell her, like, this is what's happening right now. Write this down, what she's seeing. Sometimes she could see herself in the scene, standing as an onlooker, moving between, and it was really, really vivid. And she could see things that she would never have known about living in St. Louis. So things like, you know, lamps, jugs, cooking utensils that were used, but not on display anywhere in St. Louis at a history museum at the time. On one occasion, she was shown a little bird that she didn't know what it was called, and Patience wanted to put it in the poem. Pearl had no idea what kind of the bird it was. Patience gets really frustrated with her and gets, and you know, he's like, you gotta know what this bird is. And so they're having this argument internally, and they go get an encyclopedia and they figure out what the bird is. But it was an English bird, not an American bird. So Pearl never goes into a trance. She is, you know, again, there's no theatrics against any of this. She could drink coffee, smoke cigarettes. She always could talk to everybody that was around her. Patience becomes more tolerant over time because Patience got really frustrated with how uneducated Pearl was. And that the limitations of her language frustrated Patience, the ghost in her head. And then eventually Pearl becomes pregnant. At that time, it does break a little bit, the bond does, but it comes back. So Pearl goes on, Pearl Curran goes on tour. She goes all around the country, you know, talking about Patience Worth, doing the readings and connecting with her. And it would last her entire life. Eventually she moves to California, and she dies pretty early. She dies in her 50s. But when she dies, Patience leaves her a week before that, and she dies the next week. So this connection, and no one's ever been able to prove what was actually going, but the volume of stuff that was produced, it's really intriguing. It's a fascinating story. That's all totally unbelievable. But there's one more twist that is never in any of the stories about this. And you can find a lot of what I've been talking about. This has been well written about in all kinds of St. Louis weird histories and stuff like that. But I like to find one more piece. On a local level, it gets a little more unbelievable. In 1916, Patience tells Pearl, I want you to have a baby, and I want you to name it after me, and I want to be its godmother from several hundred years before. So she urges Pearl and her husband to find a baby, but they can't, even though Pearl was pregnant at one time, the pregnancy didn't, she lost the baby, and so they didn't think they could have children. So Patience says, well, go adopt a child. So Pearl Curran adopts a baby. It is all over the news. It's covered in the newspapers, and it results in lots of babies being adopted all throughout St. Louis. It becomes kind of like a public service campaign. So she adopts the baby. The baby becomes known in the news as Ouija board baby and Patience Wee. There's a photo of her in a little Puritan bonnet, ruby cross, all that kind of stuff in 1917. Patience told Pearl that the baby was to be Spinster Prim, whatever that means. So there's a newspaper in 1917 that talks about, this baby was well known all throughout St. Louis. They covered her life, her comings and goings, and all of that stuff. Although Patience didn't talk about the baby afterwards. And then a few years later after that, there is another child that arrives, and Pearl has a baby at the age of 39, and this is when her husband is on his deathbed, so there's some sketchiness to the story and to the timeline. There's also some interestingness to this timeline of Ouija board baby. Her husband, Pearl's husband, had a 16-year-old daughter from a previous marriage, and she left town for a little while, right before before Patience Wee showed up. So it may have been a very convenient Ouija board baby here for their family. So yeah, they the two, so when the husband dies, Patience, Pearl, and the two girls. They move to California. They live out their lives there. They have kind of a tragic, they could never really recapture the attention and the fame that they had here in St. Louis. So their story ends up being pretty tragic. They both died pretty young. But yeah, so we have Ouija board baby is that story. All right. So next story is about how two brothers robbed the NBA for $800 million legally and by accident. Does anybody think they know what this one's, where this one's going? Okay. You're raising your hand for all of them. I've got a plant in here. All right. So from 1976 to 2014, one of the most profitable ownership groups in the entire National Basketball Association, NBA, was based right here in St. Louis. Their team never played a single game. The team's owners made hundreds of millions of dollars. And how it happened sounds absolutely unbelievable. The story starts in 1974. St. Louis gets its own American Baseball Association team. You may know what that team's name was? Spirits of St. Louis. See, I like doing Curran right before the Spirits of St. Louis. All right, so Spirits of St. Louis. So we get our ABA team, the Spirits. It was owned by Ozzie and Daniel. And Ozzie and Daniel Silna, two brothers, they had had a dream. They had made a huge fortune in textiles and things like that here in St. Louis. And then they buy the... So the Spirits were spurned by the NBA, so they buy it at a pretty bargain price for the ABA because it was kind of a new thing. They had players that were well-known, Marvin Bad News Barnes and Maurice the Enforcer Lucas. So they were known as a pretty quirky and entertaining teams in the entire ABA. They were not long for St. Louis. In 1976, the ABA began struggling financially, merges with the NBA. When the leagues merged, four ABA teams became part of the NBA. Hopefully you're all following that. Basically, four teams become part of the NBA, and they all get paid out, right? Their owners get a check, and they're done. But the Silnas brothers were like, nah, we're not going to do that. We'll take a small check now, but we would really love a small share of the television rights to this NBA thing. Just a little bit. The league, which was desperate to get this all done, says yes. In 1976, they're not making hardly any money off of TV, not a big deal. So how much money could this really be over time? Over the next few decades, as television rights become the whole point, the whole thing, they didn't own the team. So the Silnas did not own the team at all. They only had these little television rights. By the early 1990s, they were making $4 million a year just from those TV rights. By 2010, their yearly payout was $17 million. The league kept trying to buy them out, and they were like, nah, we're good. By 2014, the television profits for the league continued to get bigger and bigger. Finally, the NBA makes an aggressive offer big enough, $500 million. They said yes to that. One of the brothers died in 2016. The other brother is still alive. So that's a pretty wild story. And we can do Q&A at the end of this about all of these stories. The NBA one's I'm not sports heavy, but I can maybe help on this one. All right, our next one, we're going to go way back in time, a couple of decades, and we're going to have a wild night in the town in St. Louis there's the team there. We got this. Okay, we're going to have a wild night in the town at Priester's Park. So Priester's Park is at Grand and Merrimack in today's Bevo neighborhood. So if you're familiar with where Bevo Mill is, where the Stork Inn, the Feasting Fox is right there. This used to be there in that same exact spot. Now there's like gas stations and houses. So there was a huge amusement park there. They would have air balloon races. They had this big amphitheater type, that circular thing up in the top, and we're going to talk about that. And what we're here to do on our wild night out is we're going to go to the very first board track racing in St. Louis. So that track was actually one of the most sophisticated tracks or stadiums in the country. It was not built for football, baseball, or any of the things you build things for today. It was called a motordrome. And the motordrome, it was built for board track racing. So board track racing, you know, sounds like, okay, we're racing something on boards, probably at a slant of some kind, right? Probably bikes, maybe people, horses. It's a form of motorcycle racing. Competitors didn't just race their bikes on wooden tracks. Those wooden tracks were at a steep angle, like a really steep angle. So the tracks were shaped like bowls, the racers going around the sides at impossible speeds and angles. The first one was built in L.A., 1912. St. Louis opens one. It was a small amusement park called Priester's Park. It was a quarter of a mile around. The track banked at 62 degrees. It's incredibly crazy. Just look at it. Look at it. It's not real. And we were like, as it's being built, St. Louis, like the promoters are like, this is the steepest, the craziest one in the country. So guess what happens at the very first race? we quickly realize how dangerous this is. And the first race was opened August 31st, 1912. 15,000 people came to watch. And as they're watching, one of the first races of the night, a local racer named Cleve Stillwell got into a wreck while speeding around this track at 80 miles an hour, instantly killed. According to the St. Louis Star and Times, well, we're not going to go there. It's pretty gory. I forgot I included the description. Just imagine someone going 80 miles an hour on a bicycle and what that might happen. They stopped quickly. Pieces of the motorcycle break off, flies into the stands. No one, luckily, is injured in the stands. And hundreds of spectators rush to the field to help him, which confuses everybody because there are people there to actually help him. So it's like unclear as to who is a rescuer and who's just a person, you know, going to help. The police are trying to get order. So after the wreck and all this chaos, the city officials were like, okay, you can keep doing this, but you got to make some changes. And so what they did was they made sufficient exits for riders or patrons. The track was shut down for a while to add more safety features. The changes would make it not just the coolest one in the country, but the safest one, although lots of people were injured and died over the years that it was open. Yeah, by the late teens, though, they were no longer doing these races. They started doing stunt performances, and then by the 1920s, it was all gone. It was no longer a thing. But yeah, those bikes look pretty wild. Has anyone ever been to the Harley-Davidson Museum in Milwaukee? Yeah, they have an example of one of these tracks, and it's pretty wild to stand next to. So our next one, we're going to travel kind of around the same, we're going to still be in the early 20th century. If you've ever been up to Chain of Rocks Bridge, seen the water intake castles in the water, you're really close to what was at one time one of the largest and most sophisticated water treatment plants in the country, the Baden Water Works. So if you've ever been to Baden, there's nothing left, of this remnant of this huge plant that was there at one time that was taking water into, this is pre-purification, modern purification. It was taking water in from the Mississippi and then pumping it. It had a big pump station, pumping it throughout the city. And now it's all just mainly industrial space where this once was. But when it was first built, they used that water and a lot of that land to create these greenhouses. And these greenhouses also, covered the waterworks lands. They made parks that people could walk through. There's a lot of images. You can see in that upper left picture there how landscaped and beautiful the whole thing was. But during World War II, the greenhouses become part of a secret war effort. And it was hiding in absolute plain sight. What was hiding in the greenhouses was a large crop of rubber plants. They were being used by local war industry companies like Boeing, Monsanto, the ones that were getting involved in all of this, to try to create experimental materials to replace metals that were in short supply. So, right, they're struggling for metal stuff, so someone's like, well, let's try to figure out something else. This continued to be grown and cultivated into the 1960s, this like covert greenhouse operations happening in Baden. So you can go on the St. Louis public library's website. They have lots of images of people. They have lots of images of the greenhouses, of people walking around in Victorian clothing. But yeah, for a brief time, it was secret covert stuff happening in Baden. Okay. So our last story that we're going to do is Nellie Munch. Has anyone ever heard of Nellie Munch? No hand. All right, this one's pretty wild. All right, so Nellie Munch, there she is up in her window up there. This takes place in the 1930s. This is in the middle of the Great Depression, you know, right? A lot of things going on, and this story takes over the news because it's sensational. And it becomes, if you think of like, it's going to go in a direction that's very much like the musical Chicago or, you know, that kind of thing. So Nellie Munch, she is... her name is Nellie Tipton Munch. She's a well-known St. Louis socialite. She was married to a prominent physician. She was always at high society events. She's well covered in the newspaper, her social comings and goings. The story is about a kidnapping, not of her, and it has a strange connection back to Rush Limbaugh. Here we go. Okay. In this case, okay, so it started in 1931. When Dr. Isaac D. Kelly was kidnapped after making a house call to a home on Davis Place in Clayton. He was released after 8 days to a St. Louis Post-Dispatch reporter. But the person that was responsible for the temporary disappearance is unknown. So he's been kidnapped. That's the story right there, right? 3 years later, tavern owner Adolf Fiedler gives the Post-Dispatch an exclusive story. He claimed the kidnapping was the work of ex-cons, gangsters, and a woman he called Mrs. N. She was later identified as auburn-haired beauty Nellie Munch, a resident by then of Westminster Place and a prominent member, like I said, of St. Louis society. She was the daughter of a preacher. She was the sister of a judge. Again, her husband's a doctor. And she managed her own boutique in the Central West End called the Mitzi Shop. She had developed a habit of sending bills to widows for lingerie their late husbands may have or may not have bought at her shop. So even though her track record, and there's also some hints of jewelry theft, hanging out with gangsters, she's a lady of society, so she never gets in trouble for any of these rumors or things that she's doing. She's finally charged with the doctor's kidnapping, though. Her trial had a change. So she's finally charged with it. They have to have the whole trial in Mexico, Missouri, because everyone knows her here. So she's charged. She's this, character of a socialite, but also a gangster. So the trial is there, where her brother sat on the Missouri Supreme Court. They believe that the jury will not convict her if she was a new mother. She concocts a plan to get a baby to claim as her own because she didn't have any children. So working with her lawyer, Vern Lacey, she located a baby in Chicago and brought him to St. Louis. Fortunately, that baby passed away, and she found a second baby, the son of Anna Ware, an unwed domestic servant in Pennsylvania, who had come to St. Louis to deliver the child. Her plan worked. She was acquitted of the kidnapping. And at the same time, Nellie Munch also blackmailed one of her husband's colleagues, Dr. Marsh Pitzman, claiming the baby was his. So she gets money from this. When Ware went to court to get her child back, Pitzman, who had been Munch's lover, gave her $16,000 for her defense. The image on the right is people lining up to see her on the way to court. So Nellie Munch was sentenced in 1936 to 10 years for mail fraud for blackmailing Pitzman. Her husband was sentenced to 8 years. Her accomplices, Wilfred Skinny Jones, received 10 years, and her friend Helen Breuer received 5 years. And you may remember me mentioning Rush Limbaugh. One of the judges that was involved in the baby stealing part was Rush Limbaugh's grandfather. So bringing that all around. All right. Well, thank you so much. I will be hanging out afterwards if you have any questions. Love feedback, love thoughts, and hopefully I can see some of you at Saturday for the Eads Bridge exhibit unveiling, and also on some of the tour. I run our tour program, our CSTL walking and bus tour program, so hope to see you on a tour as well. Thanks, everybody.